Over the last several thousand years, trade has been one of the biggest economic and geopolitical drivers that has determined the power of nations. And there's one specific example of this that comes to mind. There is one trade route that has single-handedly created economic booms, caused deep economic recessions, was a key player in several wars, and has constantly been fought over for nearly 150 years. This is the battle for the world's most important trade route. From the 16th century to the early 19th century, the British and the French had colonized many parts of Africa, India, Southeast Asia, Oceania, and the Americas. And during that time, trade was essential for both sending supplies to build the colonies, as well as also sending resources back to the mother countries. But both the British and the French ran into a little bit of a problem. You see, for example, if Britain wanted to trade with India, they would have one of two options. The first option is that they would need to travel from London all the way around the most southern part of Africa before crossing the Indian Ocean and completing the 20,000 kilometer journey to India. The second option is that they would have to travel from London around Portugal through the Mediterranean, then transport the goods by land through Egypt before loading the goods back on ships in the Red Sea and finally crossing the Indian Ocean. Needless to say, both of these options were extremely inefficient, but at the time, they were the best options available. That was until the 1830s when French explorer Lillant de Bellefonds conducted a survey of land around the Isthmus of the Suez, which is a 125 kilometer strip of land between the Mediterranean Sea and the Red Sea. And what he found was that the Mediterranean and the Red Sea actually lied at the same altitude, meaning that theoretically a canal with no locks could potentially be built connecting the two bodies of water. Now, a few decades later in 1850, French diplomat Ferdinand de Lesseps was given permission from the Egyptian government to create a company that would be responsible for constructing a canal and also operating the canal for 99 years. Now, this company raised money from a range of French, British, Egyptian, and American investors, and on April 25th, 1859, work on the Suez Canal began. It took 1.5 million laborers, $100 million, and 10 years to complete this project. But nonetheless, on November 17, 1869, the canal was opened under French control. Celebrations began with fireworks, a banquet, high-end yachts, and world leaders all contributing to the inauguration of this canal. And this was the first time in history where ships traveled between the Mediterranean Sea and the Red Sea without having to travel around the bottom of Africa. And this was revolutionary, as cargo ships, naval ships, and just about any kind of sea-bearing vessel could now cut over 8,000 kilometers and several weeks off of its travel time between Europe, Africa, and Asia. This was the moment when the Suez Canal became the most important trade route in the world, because all of a sudden, the three most populated continents on the planet at the time had one single efficient trade route between one another. And the effects of the canal were seen almost immediately as trade between continents increased fairly rapidly over the next several years. But this economic effect wasn't positive for all nations. You see, the British Empire had colonized most of southern Africa and its surrounding islands. These colonies' economies were largely dependent upon ships that would stop at their ports, store some of their goods in British warehouses, and inject some money into the local economy. But once the Suez Canal opened, these ships stopped showing up. And the most impacted colony at the time might have been the British island of St. Helena. In 1855, the island of St. Helena saw 1,100 cargo ships stop at its ports. And just a few decades later, only 288 ships passed through St. Helena's ports. Now, this massive reduction of ships passing through Britain's southern African colonies helped cause one of the worst economic declines in Britain's history. This was called the Panic of 1873. And this panic in Britain caused a recession that lasted 6 years. In fact, this 6-year period is the longest contraction of an economy in history, even longer than the Great Depression of the 1930s. This economic decline in Britain stretched into a 2-decade-long stagnation called the Long Depression, where there was virtually no economic growth during that time. However, just a few years after the Panic of 1873, Britain saw the value of the Suez Canal, and they became the first country to attempt to gain full control over the world's most important trade route. In 1875, they bought a 44% stake in the Suez Canal for $19.2 million and became the second largest shareholder next to France. But that wasn't enough. Britain wanted to ensure that it had full control over the greatest shipping route in the world, so in 1882 they invaded Egypt and Sudan. This invasion resulted in a suppression of a nationalist uprising in Egypt, also a dramatic decrease in French and Ottoman influence in the area, and of course gave Britain 100% control over the Suez Canal. And this was the first time in history that the canal had started a war, or at the very least was a large contributing factor to a war. But it would be far from the last. Over the next several decades, traffic in the Suez Canal continued to grow, which made it even more important to both Britain, who controlled the canal, and virtually every other major country in Africa, Asia, and Europe that used the canal. So that's why in 1914, during World War I, the Suez Canal was viewed as one of the major strategic regions in the world, because whoever controlled the canal could prevent naval ships from traveling between Africa, Asia, and Europe in record time, and force the enemy to take a two-week detour around Africa in order for ships to get to their destination. So when the war began, Britain sent 30,000 troops to the Suez with the sole purpose of defending the canal in case any German or Ottoman forces were to attempt an attack. And shortly after, an attack came. You see, the Germans and Ottomans viewed the Suez as such a key strategic point of the war that they started mobilizing their troops for an attack on the Suez just 5 days after the war started. But the British were prepared. They successfully defended the raid on the Suez Canal, which was a battle that lasted for nearly 2 weeks in early 1915, and they fended off all other attacks on the Suez for the remainder of World War I while maintaining full control of the canal. However, after the war was over, Egyptians began rebelling against Britons over the control of the canal. It was in 1936 when the British signed a treaty with Egypt, where the British would withdraw all of its troops from Egypt and make Egypt an independent state, but conditional upon the British being allowed to keep a military base to protect and maintain full control over the Suez Canal. And even though many Egyptian nationalists were upset with this treaty at the time, as many of them viewed the Suez as Egyptian property and should be under the control of Egypt, just 3 years later, the decision to keep a military base to protect the Suez would prove to be vital for the world. Because on September 1st, 1939, Germany invaded Poland, and therefore World War II was underway. You see, during World War II, the Suez Canal was one of the biggest supply lines, shipping routes, and transportation methods in the world. So when the war began, Britain immediately shut off the canal to the Axis powers, while also utilizing the canal to help the Allies. And that is why, as soon as the war started, the Axis powers started an offensive campaign to try and capture the canal. In 1940, the British fended off a preliminary attack from the Italians. But in 1941, a significantly larger German and Italian force was sent to Libya and Egypt in order to capture the Suez. And this offensive campaign forced British troops back to the point where most people thought that the Axis powers would control the canal, and therefore cut off one of the Allies' key supply and transportation lines, which would have swung the tides of the war. But the British started a counteroffensive campaign to force the Axis powers out of the Suez. And on October 23, 1942, the British launched their campaign and began forcing the Axis powers out of the Suez, then eventually Egypt, and finally on May 13, 1943, the Axis had completely withdrawn from Africa. But one can't help but wonder what would have happened if the British were not allowed to keep a military presence in the Suez before the war started. Or what would have happened if the Axis were able to capture the Suez in 1941 or 1942. The view of most historians was that the Suez was vital in both supplying the British military and also preventing the Axis powers from taking over the entire Mediterranean. So if the Axis were to have taken over the canal early enough in the war, it is not only possible, but likely, that the Axis powers would have won the war. But that is not what happened, because on September 2nd, 1945, the Axis powers surrendered and the Allies had won. But But this was far from the end of the story for the world's most important trade route. In 1951, Egypt began to repudiate the treaty that it had signed with the British, while also making the superpowers of the world financially compete for friendship with Egypt. So eventually, the British, French, and Americans got mad that Egypt was taking too much financial support from the Soviets, which made the three Western countries withdraw all of their support for Egypt's massive Aswan Dam project. And of course, this angered Egypt. You see, just 8 days after the British withdrew its troops from Egypt, Egypt decided to nationalize the Suez Canal and close the Straits of Tyran to all Israeli ships. This was the start of what became known as the Suez Crisis. This was a crisis where Israel retaliated against Egypt's geopolitical actions, which eventually started a war, where the goal was to control the Straits of Tyran and the Suez Canal. Now, the British and the French joined the Israeli forces, but this was an extremely unpopular decision with many countries around the world. So that is why Canadian Lester B. Pearson came up with a proposal for the United Nations. The proposal was for Egypt to maintain neutrality of the canal so that all countries in the world would have access to it. The proposal also created the first United Nations peacekeeping force, and it also called for a ceasefire and de-escalation of the war. This proposal was eventually passed by the United Nations, which ended the Suez Crisis and earned Lester B. Pearson the Nobel Peace Prize of 1957. Now, the end of the crisis gave Egypt full control over the Suez Canal, conditional upon it maintaining neutrality, which was viewed as a major win for Egypt, as it now was acknowledged as the owner of the world's most important trade route. And over the next 10 years, the traffic on the Suez Canal continued to grow, while greatly benefiting Egypt, who was able to take fees from each ship passing through the canal. But in 1967, another war broke out between Israel and Egypt, where Israel gained partial control over the Suez Canal. In response, Egypt imposed a blockade in the canal, which trapped 15 cargo ships from 8 different countries in the middle of the Suez. Now, this blockade did not just last a day, a week, a month, or even a year. The blockade lasted 8 years and trapped these cargo ships inside for that entire duration. Even though most of these people working on these ships were able to be evacuated, in some cases the crew members were stuck on these ships in the middle of the Suez Canal for several years. Now, in 1974, Egypt wanted to reopen the canal, but the trouble was that it was filled with mines from the war. In fact, it took an entire year of minesweeping from British and American ships in order to clear the Suez Canal. But eventually, in 1974, the world's most important trade route was reopened to the world after an 8-year closure. And this was nearly perfect economic timing, because this was right before China shifted its economic policy away from communism, which resulted in them becoming the manufacturing hub of the world. And the most efficient trade route between China, Europe, and parts of Africa was the Suez Canal. So the traffic on the canal continued to grow while helping boost the Egyptian economy. And even though there have been several conflicts surrounding Egypt over the past 4.5 decades, the Suez Canal has been relatively peaceful and neutral during that entire time. Now, in a previous video, I made an error and said that the Panama Canal had the most traffic of any canal-based trade route in the world by quite a bit. But in reality, the Suez and the Panama Canals have been going back and forth as the most used canals in the world, with the Suez having a slight edge in terms of overall traffic. For example, last year, the Suez Canal had roughly 18,000 cargo ships pass through its waters, while the Panama Canal had roughly 17,000 ships pass through its waters. And so how much money does the Suez make for Egypt? Well, the typical fee that is charged to each one of these cargo ships is in the neighborhood of $50,000, and in some cases can be upwards of $400,000. So the canal itself is generating over $1 billion a year for Egypt and is indirectly responsible for trillions of dollars worth of goods passing through its waters every single year. The Suez has also gone through several expansion projects that have allowed significantly larger ships to pass through its waters, making it a more efficient trade route than ever before. But there are new contenders looking to join the competition for the world's most important trade route. You see, the Arctic has been slowly melting over the past 200 years or so, which has allowed for some ships to traverse the Northeast Passage in Russia, which is a direct competitor to the Suez Canal. China has also financed a canal in Nicaragua and a railway in Israel to serve as another competitor to the Suez, but both of these projects have been delayed indefinitely. So at the end of the day, the Suez Canal is the most important canal canal and trade route in the world. It has been the creator of wealth and the cause of recessions, the instigator of political decisions, and a key player in many wars. And as globalization continues to accelerate, with trade increasing for virtually every country on the planet, the Suez will continue to be a big player in the world's economy. And even though it has not been involved in a conflict in over 40 years, and I hope that continues, what history has told us is that peace in the Suez is a rare thing. So we should enjoy this time while we can. Now, if you liked this video, you will for sure like my video on Canada's Northwest Passage in the Panama Canal, so make sure to check that out or click on my documentaries playlist. Also, make sure to hit that like and subscribe button down below. It would mean a lot to me if you did that, and I cannot believe how much this channel has grown over the last few months, so thank you all very much. And again, just make sure to click on my next video, and I will see you guys in that video in just a few seconds.